Okay, I would like to start the afternoon session, live demonstration from Assam Medical Center. For these sessions, let me invite Dr. Shaiban and Dr. Stone as moderator, Dr. Busman, Dr. Chen, Dr. Cohen, Dr. Hutchison, Dr. Yang Shang, Dr. Kim, Dr. Lim, Dr. Wu, Dr. Yamaguchi, Dr. Zhang as discussant. I think the Assam Medical Center is ready.
Good afternoon.
Hi, Greg. All right. Okay, so we just prepared another exciting the main cases. So would you show angiogram first? All right, Dr. Okay. Bach here, Dr. Zhang. Actually, one of our family, Dr. Gary Minchi is here, and so he will help us on the whole procedure.
Yeah. Okay, okay, I'm going to introduce patient history and 49-year-old male and visited outpatient clinic and 1 month ago. The patient complained after related chest pain. Baseline electrocardiogram shows normal, but the thallium scan shows a large reversible perfusion defect in LAD territory. And so we check up the coronary angiogram and show some beautiful image. And look at the patient medical history. There was no myocardial infarction, no PCI. And look at the risk factor. It's just hypertension and the previous ex-smoker. And clinically, after full medication, patient symptom was totally stabilized.
Right. Can you see the angiogram?
So very, very interesting. So SJ, are you going to do FFR to see if this is a significant lesion?
Right. So exactly. Correct. All right. I got a story. This patient, 1 month ago, we had an acute coronary syndrome, retro chest pain. However, we are going to wait. Actually, we waited for the 2 days lab cases, right? So this is our first angiogram, and I didn't show the the 2 days angiogram. Anyway, very tight stenosis, changes to the little bit, you know, large lumens and negative FFR 1 month later. Greg, what do you think? Is it treat or not treat? Okay, just a guess about this. It's from the beginning. Anyway, 1 month later, minimal lumen area is getting bigger, negative FFR. What do you think?
Yeah,
do you want to treat that?
I don't think there's any doubt you're going to treat this. I think, it's not impossible that it would stabilize. I mean, it clearly looks like a severely ulcerated ruptured plaque. It's not impossible that it stabilizes and that there's some thrombus there that resolves over time, but I think that's taking a huge chance for this patient. And I would anybody on the panel take that chance? Or even consider taking the chance. I had a different question that I want to ask maybe John Hodgson and then some of our imaging experts. It would be very interesting to see what this looks like with an advanced imaging tool. Would that change knowing the composition, knowing if there was thrombus, knowing if it looks like there was a calcified nodule or if it's an erosion as opposed to a rupture? Would anything you find change what you do in the cath lab for this patient?
I don't think it would change whether I'm going to do something. I think this is going to be a crossover into that LAD, and it's going to happen no matter what I find. But and I don't see a lot of angiographic calcium, so I'm not too concerned about at least getting started and then maybe using the IVUS intermediately to guide the procedure. But there's nothing that I'm going to find that's going to keep me from treating this patient.
Anybody else?
Okay. Definitely, IVUS would be very important because a proper evaluation of the diameter of proximal LAD and left main will help to select the best size of the stents. So definitely, that this is very important. In some cases, also the length of the lesion can be very well calculated. Especially in this case, may play also important role. Just calculation of the length or of the stent we need for this case.
Okay, so in order to save the time, actually we have done already two separate arms long using the near system, and so. Okay, I was Chris Keller, I was first. Gary, would you explain that?
So, Greg, I'm going to show the IVUS pullback from the LAD to left main with the Boston Scientific system. Can you see it?
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
Fine. So here we're in the LAD. You can see it's a huge vessel in the 4 to 5 millimeter range with circumferential plaque. Then we're going to see the circumflex come in at around 12 o'clock. The lumen area at this point is about 3.5. And if I can find it, opposite is a plaque. Okay, so right opposite. Right opposite the circumflex is a plaque rupture.
Yep.
Okay.
Very
okay.
Nice.
So that's the plaque rupture you see right at the ostium of the LAD. It's kind of at the roof of the left main. Mm-hmm. And then we go more proximal, and you'll see a second plaque rupture at 180 degrees opposite the first, right here, with attenuated plaque and a luminary in the 2 range.
So Gary, do you really think do you think it's 2 plaque ruptures, or is it 1 spiral plaque rupture in the same plaque?
Well, I mean, I actually think it's 2. Because if you go between the 2, you see nothing. And they're really 180 degrees apart. I mean, this is between.
Very interesting, yeah.
I mean, could I imagine that's a plaque rupture that started here and burrowed and, you know,
right.
I mean, anything's possible. I mean, maybe a little bit of thrombus here, but it looks like 2 plaque ruptures that are 180 degrees opposite each other.
Seems to be a step.
And then, of course, the left main is, you know, is again huge. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6,
yeah.
And the length is about 19 to 20 millimeters.
Right.
Okay, so this was another. Okay, we have another DR system obviously for the just you know interest about the repeat content. So, Gary will show
us. Other than to say that there are 2 plaque ruptures. Okay.
Okay.
So now we're going to pull back. Can you see the Near's IVUS?
We do. The image looks a little grainy, but we do see it.
Well, it's grainy.
Okay.
And here's the circumflex coming in here.
Circumflex, right?
I believe, maybe it's the time.
Is this the new system, Gary, the HD system?
No.
Okay.
And then here you can see the plaque rupture opposite. With some lipid-rich plaque, not a whole lot. And I really don't see the other, you know, the plaque rupture at 180 degrees, which would be here, and you see some more extension of the lipid proximally. So there's, you know, there's modest lipid in the region of at least one of the plaque ruptures.
So Gary, was that pullback from the CERC this time? It just looked different than the last
one.
No. Okay.
Well, they're both from the LAD.
Okay.
There's a lot of movement, it seemed, in the catheter. It made it difficult to interpret.
Well, correct. The frame rate of the 2 machines is different. So the frame rate of the Near's IVUS in order to accomplish the, you know, having two devices, has a slower frame rate. And if the catheter is moving a lot, as it is in this patient, because if they can move, you know, 5 millimeters, then you have a little bit of problem.
So, Greg, actually, the Gary told us the minimum lumen area is 3.0 millimeters.
No, actually, 3.0 in one place, 3.5 in one place, and 2 in another place.
All right.
But they're very, very short.
3.5 millimeter minimum lumen area. So, actually, we didn't do the FFR, right? All right, we're going to treat this one. Dr. Bello, would you describe how would you treat them? Actually, the ulcer part of circumference is free of disease.
Yes.
Many palatable ruptured plaque, and two ruptured plaque, and the proximal area, the main shaft. And however, right, in terms of procedure strategy, how would you do that?
Yes, as everybody know that simple procedure, the angiography shows the very complex procedure, but we already checked circumflex ostium is definitely normal. And so I think just the stent crossover the definitely feasible for this patient, yes.
Sure. Would you discuss about that?
I think everybody would, anybody feel different than that on the panel?
SJ, the only question I have is, we've only seen this one view. It looks like there's an obtuse marginal lesion there. Do you believe that's significant? And if so, you know, did you want to step
We
in?
Have already, actually, we have done others for the, you know, obtuse marginal, big circumflex, separate lung. So we clearly know that, that there was a free of disease of a circumflex. So
yeah, not the ostium, but the branch. That branch that's going to 12 o'clock in this picture.
Exchange is one question regarding the size, because LAD osteo and the circumflex in the left main is quite
circumflex proper.
I mean that
right. LAD circumflex is proper concern. There are some narrowings. However, all right, I didn't too much deal about that. It's just you know main LAD to main and. Okay, we're going to see that.
Yeah, because the crossover, I think everybody agrees. But the sizing, what is your size of your choice?
So the sizing isn't that discrepant. You know, the left main is, you know, 5 to 6, and the proximal LAD is 4 to 5. Mm-hmm. So it's about a millimeter difference. I mean, I've seen a lot worse.
Mm-hmm. Actually, we have not a choice. There's a 4 millimeter size of stent is biggest. How can I do that? So we're going to do a little bit more expandable stent, kind of a resolute integrity.
Yes.
I believe it kind of, you know, design condition is more coil-like, you know, reactions. And so we're going to do resolute integrity and do, you know, compression flex.
So the resolute's a nice choice when you want a stent that you could put in a 4-0, you could take it up to 5-0.
Test.
And so you're not pre-dialing, you're just doing
the test.
You're doing just direct stenting. And I think I think that's reasonable on the basis of the IVUS, you know, which showed no calcium. It's a typical Korean left vein.
Slowly, 6.
Gary, as we've talked, this pathology always looks different than the Western European or United States left vein atherosclerosis.
16. Deeply.
Does anybody think the
circumflex
is going to be there?
Okay, we select resolute 4.022.
Anyone think the circumflex will be narrowed?
No. Okay, and Joe? Okay, good.
We can't hear you, Gary.
Non-compliant balloony.
So again, there was a reasonable discrepancy. Are you going to settle with a 4-0 non-compliant balloon for the left main, or are you going to do something larger in the left main?
The IVUS measure, the vessel size is the left main is 4.8.
Left main was 5.5.
Close to 5. Up to 5, yes. Okay, we'll check the coronary angio again.
And it always looks good by the angio.
Should. Okay.
I agree.
So what do you think about FFR measurement of the diagonal?
Yes, the FFR would be a good option for to check the diagonal branches. Can I ask the panel opinion? Is the post-balloon dilation, a non-compliant balloon is needed or not for this patient at this stage? Yes.
I would say yes. I would personally do a 4-0 in the left main and a 5-0 in the, yes. I'm sorry, 4-0 in the proximal LED and a 5-0 in the left main. I wouldn't worry about the diagonal. That is the least of this patient's problems.
Yeah, right.
50 or 60% diagonal lesion.
Actually, you can check with IVUS about the position of the stent.
Okay, got it. Yeah. Yes.
You still want the, I think, the maximum, you know, stent expansion and the largest minimal stent area you can get. And you know from IVUS that it can take a very large balloon.
Okay. Okay, checked. IVUS.
So we're going to image the LED back to the left main again. And while we're pulling back, Greg, I just want to, you know, emphasize what you said. I mean, every time we come here, we see disease that's very different from what we see back home.
Yeah. That's so interesting.
So we're getting to the distal end of the stent,
yeah.
I think. So there's the there's that big diagonal, sorry. And here's the distal end of the stent, you know, which is, you know, properly sized, no distal edge problems, you know, nothing.
Yeah, it's opposed. It looks fine.
Yes.
It's a very soft platform. Now here.
Yeah, the circumflex is somewhere up in here.
Here you're not getting fantastic imaging, but
it'll crack up
a lot of nerd.
Sorry.
Okay.
And now we're seeing some lack of apposition here.
Yeah, yeah. Near the,
you know,
near
the just at the proximal
therapy. Yeah.
So the recheck the IVUS, I think the proximal portion is okay. So I'm gonna do additional the balloon dilation for left main ostium using.
So Howard, what would you do at this point?
I agree. I think the the proximal LED looks good. The proximal portion of the stent looks like it's a little bit under deployed. So doing a high pressure balloon would be great.
Well, first of all, you don't need a high pressure.
But just a 5.
Yeah, it's really its size. This is more size than pressure, right?
I mean, there's nothing behind it except blood.
Yeah.
Just 5.
Anybody else? Another opinion?
And the minimal stent here, Greg, is about 13.
Yeah, yes.
Can we see another projection, maybe?
What's the LED, Gary, the MSA and the LED?
The ostium of circ.
You mean the stent?
The stent, middle stent area stent. And the LED.
Hold a second. It'll be here. It's going to be close to what it is in left main.
Yeah. We'll show the another image and to show the circ ostium test. Okay. And Joe?
Look how steady Gary's hands are.
Okay. This could be about the same through the whole length.
So, I'm sorry, what is
it? I mean, part of it, because it's 13.
13, yeah. So that's fantastic in the LED. But, I think the left main, you also, I don't think you want this to be a straight conical. I mean, you want to have, I think, hemodynamically a larger left main laminar flow going into the circ in the LED. So, you're going to use a short focal 5-0 balloon?
Yes, I'm going to use the 5-0 balloon for the left main ostium position.
So you're doing a pot technique.
But left main ostium is not seen, not covered by the stent.
And actually it is.
It was pretty close to it, and the disease wasn't at the left main ostium. So
right.
Either way, I think you're fine. So you're really doing a pot here. Basically,
you basically have a little bit left main that was not covered from here to here, but it's pretty much covered. And the plaque burden at the left main is actually minimal.
Right. Definitely, this is a 5.0, non-compliant.
What pressure did you go to?
It's a 12. Okay, go 12, 14. Definitely, okay. I'll check the IBIS again.
So one question that somebody just mentioned. So you did this femoral. Why not radial?
Yeah, right. Yes, you know, in our center, we usually for the complex region, the top bifurcation region, left main region, the calcified region, we prefer the femoral approach. You know, many center is now doing the left main intervention via a radial approach, but for me and for our another member faculties, femoral approach would be feasible and comfortable for us.
So I'd be interested to hear from the panel. So this was a complex appearing left main lesion, but it's a very straightforward procedure. So who would have done this radial, and who would send the patient home on the same day?
Okay, go.
I guess we have, based on our 20 years of transfer experience, left main is quite comfortable using a radial approach. If we have considering more complex procedure, for example, two-stand techniques, we nowadays can use Schüchlin's technique, so 6.5 French or 7.5 French. Schüchlin's is quite reasonable to accommodate this kind of complex procedures.
And would you send the patient home on the same day?
Usually not, because the left main we still keep overnights.
But when you think about it, the likelihood of anything happening to this left main overnight is pretty low.
We occasionally in the U.S. can pretty easily get a 7 French sheath in the radial, but in a vessel this big where you may be doing bifurcation balloons or something, it gets pretty tight in a 6 French. I'd like to have at least a 7 as an option.
I think a 6 is okay. For two balloons, I think a 6 is okay.
Well, I mean, it's doable. It's just
any rate.
Okay.
So we're coming up the left main. It's a little better.
A little better. Not markedly better, but a little better.
No, a little better. But, Greg, as we've looked at over and over again,
it's fine.
This isn't going to have any impact.
Right. Right. The amount of malapposition you had before would not have had any impact.
Right.
Right.
Okay, we...
except if you get the wire behind it, right?
Yeah, I think the left main stenting would be successful, and next we're going to check the FFR for diagonal branch, and is there any comment for the panel to think about the additional the manipulation needed for this patient?
So what about easing opening of circ?
I think what is necessary has been done, and...
Could you show us another view of the osteal circ? Mm.
Okay, got it.
Can we see
it
abdominal,
looks very good here.
Abdominal projection?
Test. Okay, got it. This is aerial coral view. And,
I think, we're trying to make this complicated. I think you got a great result. The patient's going to do terrific. Here in this view, it looks like there's a tight lesion in that that posterior circumflex branch, but it's a small vessel that doesn't supply a lot of myocardium.
Yeah, right.
I think you just see how the patient does. Hmm.
Okay, and we'll check the spider view. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Great result.
I think it's fantastic. It looks just
great.
Yes,
thank you. And thank you. We're going to finish the procedure and check the FFR for diagonal branch. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it will
Hello,
be
bonjour, Marie-Claude.
Hello, Greg. How are you?
Très bien, merci. Et vous?
Oh, your French is...
That's about the extent of my French.
Year, year. year after year. Hello, so we are also dealing with the left main patient, so my partners will present you the case and what we have done so far.
Hi, Greg. Hey. Expert panels, Vincent Kwok. So we've got a 64-year-old man who had a brain tumor and operated on about 4 to 6 weeks before. But he developed ACS with non-ST elevation MI, and cardiac catheterization at that juncture showed a distal left main critical stenosis at the trifurcation. Of course, because of immediate post-op situation, they delayed the angioplasty, and the patient was pretty stable. And you, as you can see on the angiogram, it's a complex trifurcation and a critical distal left main, and it's pretty calcified, actually. And there is another lesion in the mid-LAD, and a moderate disease in the left circumflex, and all the way diseased ramus. And up to now, we did IVUS. Let's show the IVUS, right? Yeah, we did IVUS of the left main LAD and also the circumflex.
Right. Yeah, so that LAD is diffusely diseased. I mean, you can see the LAD is diffusely diseased. There's a lot of plaque.
Yeah.
So, Greg, this is the circumflex.
Okay.
Okay. And this is also diffusely diseased. There's more disease downstream that I'm not showing. But it's a big circumflex. And obviously, the key issue is what's happening at the ostium of the circumflex. And we'll see the LAD coming in. Some in here, some calcification.
You put the gain up just a little bit.
It's already recorded, John.
Yeah, all right. The brightness then, whatever.
Wow. The producers can do it, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yep.
All right. So this is the ostium of the circumflex.
Which is not bad, huh?
Which is fine.
Huh? It's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Okay.
Now we'll look at the LAD.
A lot of calcification that distal left main, though.
Yeah, well, you see that already.
Okay, so now you IVUS'd in the LAD direction?
Right.
Yeah.
So go ahead and enlarge the IVUS, thank you.
See some calcium here, you see some NERD. It's a lot of electrical interference from something.
Yeah.
And no, John, I can't increase the gain, and I can't increase the brightness. Now, this was after predilation, Marie-Claude?
No, at the left main, we predilate, but not the LAD.
Not the LAD.
This is the lesion of the LAD, yeah.
Because there's something, you know, there's something in the LAD. You'll see, here's a secondary lesion in the LAD.
Oh, yeah, look at that.
And then we'll get to some.
Okay, so... Almost 270 degrees.
Was that the mid LAD, Gary? There, that one?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Because there was a septal and diagonal right
after. This is the proximal. Huh?
Right. Mm-hmm. This is again the prox LAD, and you see this is the tight stenosis in the prox LAD. You know, diffusely diseased. I mean, it's interesting to contrast this with the case we just saw.
Yeah, this looks like more like our disease.
Correct. And I hate to put it that way, but it is kind of the way it is. You know, it looks like a good old fashioned American LAD left main.
Yeah. Okay, so obviously in this case, lesion preparation is going to be really critical.
Mm-hmm. You see, a huge plaque burden.
Yeah.
It's a godsend that the ostial circ is okay.
Yeah, absolutely. Here's the circumflex coming in.
Yeah.
Yep.
The huge rock of calcium.
You know?
Yep.
Yes. Although the lumen at the site of calcium is not, you know, is not tiny.
Yeah, but it's going to, everything has to expand towards the circ because nothing's going to move towards that rock.
Yeah.
All right, so a lot to discuss here. So in this patient, you said is 4 to 6 weeks after neurosurgery?
Yeah.
And are the neurosurgeons comfortable with prolonged aspirin and clopidogrel?
Yes, I think they already
they fixed,
healed.
They fixed the...
And the right coronary is okay? They fixed the brain.
First, it's a small one. You see that we are in the very dominant left system, very dominant. So right is small, and I would say diffusely diseased with any focal. But it's a very small artery. And you see the size and the territory of the circus is enormous.
Okay, so to summarize, you've got a trifurcation left main, you've got a high-grade stenosis in the prox to mid-LAD, which I think needs to be treated as well, and and you've got a lot of calcification. So let's open it up to the panel. What technique are you going to – does everyone want to try to get away with a single crossover stent to the LAD with wire in the ramus and wire in the circumflex? And if so, how are you going to prepare the LAD? You're going to use balloon angioplasty? Are you going to use cutting scoring balloons? Or are you going to do some sort of atherectomy? Dr. Lim?
I think that even though calcification is severe, I think we can open the balloon. So I choose the angioscope.
Okay, so angioscope balloon with crossover technique?
Crossover, yes.
Any other opinions?
Because from the IVUS looks to me, it's not a ring calcification, and also the chasm, we can see some separation. So non-compartmental should be good for preparation. Then see how that balloon responds to the lesions. Then we can decide.
Gary, can you tell what kind of that I'm looking at this angle going into the LAD, which looks severe there. Is that just a looking at the wire bias? Is that a just a big crotch of calcium? I must say, I've got, you'll hate it, but I'm tempted to run a 1.5 burr into that LAD. But I think you need the least scoring balloons, but I'd be tempted to run a 1.5 burr. And I think you'll get a lot of ablation of the calcium because of the wire bias and where the burr is going to sit.
And I also think it's important to use a fully sized balloon in that mid LAD and ensure that you can crack that. I see there's already a stent there. It does look a little underexpanded in the center of it.
See, that's a big calcified nodule.
Yeah.
You know, I think right there. So, every time I think of atherectomy and I don't do it, I usually feel bad. Marie-Claude, what's your thinking?
No, we pre-dilate with a trio non-compliant that opened well. And then we put, my initial plan was to do 2 spastentin, but in fact you saw by IVUS that all LAD is diffuse disease. So we said that we have to cover everything. And we implanted the first 3.5 34 millimeter stent at 12 atmosphere that was not correctly open. I knew that. But instead of going higher pressure more proximally and not to descend, I took the balloon off, and I'm back with a non-compliant 3.5 to open well the zone which is clearly underexpanded, which is exactly there. Can you see it?
Yeah, yeah, we see that very well.
So let's go up. Yeah, 18.
That was the tight spot in the LAD originally?
Yeah, exactly. You see, it looks better now. We went to 18. I think we can go up to 20. We are non-compliant. Let's open that properly.
What kind of stent do you use?
Yeah. It's a Zions. It's a long Zions.
20. I think that concept of going to 20 is very important. High pressure is not 14, it's over 20. You really have to be up in the 20.
I'd be at 30 atmospheres at this lesion without thinking twice about it.
I'd go as high as you could get.
Especially if you're not going to decalcify it.
honestly, the balloon seems to open this time. We went to 20. We will see. If we need more, we will do more. Yeah. No problem. So the next step will be to put the stent, the second stent. We make the measurement with the length of the balloon. Maybe you can show that. And it was the same length from, you see, the 24. No, 34, sorry, was okay. Yeah. So we will take 34. Question is, do we take a 4-0 or a 3-5? Gary, does the Prox LED will afford a 4-0 or not?
The Prox LED?
Yeah.
Right.
No.
No.
No. No.
So we take again the 3-5 and we will bot after, no problem.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's take 34, 3-5, please.
Show us that Prox LED, Gary. Is there any place you could see the EM?
No. So here's the circumflex. And kind of, not really.
Well, close. There maybe.
About close as it gets.
You could probably take a 4, don't you think?
With all this, I'd probably stick with a 3-5 and post dilate.
Yeah, it's calcified. Let don't take the risk of having a rupture. Huh?
Okay. We're not arguing.
Later.
Patient has enough problems like that. We have to stay on the safe side. Okay.
Yeah.
I hope we'll be long enough.
So
have you pre-dilated the left main region at all with the balloons you've had in already?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, we did.
Okay. So which balloon you choose for the pre-dilatation?
3-5 non-compliance.
3-5. Mm-hmm.
So would anybody treat this with a bioresorbable scaffold? Antonio might.
Well.
Anybody else? Ashok might.
Absolutely.
Actually, maybe after rotablation.
It's
not the idea
of
patient.
No.
Let's go more cranial to show that we are okay, because I want to cover the ostium.
Maris, what kind of wire you have in the circ?
It's 3 BMW. Let's go caudal. It was difficult to go in the LED because of the big angulation and the severity of the lesion. The two intermediate and surf was easy. If I could be a little more proximal, it would be better. Huh?
Yeah.
I need 1 millimeter more proximal. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And what kind of wire you have in the circ?
Everything is BM. W. Sorry. Let's film. This time I think we are at the ostium.
Yeah, the iliocranial was really nice to see the ostium.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
That should be all right.
10, 12, 14.
Yeah.
Now we can go caudal again. And we will, can we have the caudal view?
Caudal.
Yeah, caudal.
Yep.
Thank you. So, we will post-dilate the LED with the 3-5. And Gary, tell me which size I need for the left main. At least the 5-0, no? Or 4-5?
4.5.
Okay, so first
you're gonna go high pressure
the 3-5 to better dilate the to post-dilate the proximal LED. And
Maurice, Marie, what kind of why you have in CERC?
Why do you care?
I do.
That's the polymer jacket showed once.
Is it kind of phobic or it's
they're all BMWs?
All BMWs.
Or
no,
BMWs?
BMW. BMW. Okay. So I think that proxality is not too bad. It's clear that we need.
Yeah, there's clearly under expansion at the ostium of the LED, and there's you can see the usual little narrowing at the ostial surface.
Let's take the 3.5.
Marie, would you remove the wires first before further post-dilatation of left main with higher pressures?
Yeah, we usually leave the wire.
Oh, I leave the wire. I am at the safe side with the. Honestly, I never had a metallic stent blocked. Instead, you put two stents in a row. That can create problem, but with a. With a single stent crossover like that, honestly, I'm not afraid at all.
I totally agree.
I had a bad experience with the BMW after high pressure dilatation of the main stent, left vessel stenting, especially with the BMW. That's why I'm asking.
Because BMW
has very special construction. It actually consists of three parts. Sometimes it can be dismounted. That's why I'm asking.
If you change the black part of your wire, yes, you can get problem, but not the metallic.
So did you uncoil a wire? You had a BMW uncoil, or you couldn't get it out, or what?
The wire was disconnected.
So it fractured.
So I had to move special. I used special technique to remove it later, but it was the problem. So actually, I prefer to use at the moment hydrophilic. Wires.
But not a polymer jacket coated wire, because there you can strip off the polymer.
I haven't seen it actually.
Well, you can't see it. You'll never see it. It'll just thrombose the artery.
We tested in vitro model. We haven't seen any problem.
So we went to 20, both in the proximal LED and in the left main, and now we will take a short 4.5.
Okay.
Non-compliant balloon to.
I still think that there's under
or left main.
Some under expansion right at that ostial LED. That's that you can see all the calcium right there. We'll see what it looks like
but
by
the balloon is parallel.
I think
John's saying you're not going to move it, but if you had a short, I would put a short 4.0 non-compliant balloon right at that crotch.
Yeah. But we'll be limited by the classification.
You'll be able to.
Before doing that, I will cut my left main and do the IVUS. And that we will know what needs more work, yes or no.
It's still large, so you still probably will have a pretty good stent area. But
that's why I
would have run a rotablator, just to have made some effect on that calcium.
Non-compliant,
in the roof there.
It's for the left main,
would do more work for the lap circumference?
And you think the wire bias would be enough to cause it to?
Yeah, I think the wire bias would have turned the 1.5 burr into a 2.5 burr, effectively. It would have. You could see where the wire is. It would have gone right into that plaque.
The good news is that the patient is very well tolerating. It's surprising when you see that there is near no right coronary artery, and despite that, inflation are very well tolerated.
Yeah.
This
is 4.5, huh? Yeah. Okay, we are in place. Let's go up. Yeah. 14?
Yeah,
15, 16. 15, 15. So we are all remarking just how stable most left main angioplasties are.
Yeah.
you know, unless you've got a patient with severe LV dysfunction.
Yeah, and to get exactly the ostium.
You know, it's rare that you need a balloon pump or an impello or any sort of support devices.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, exactly.
18?
20.
20.
I'm doing the ostium at the moment. Okay. We went to 22. So okay. I will re-enter carefully my my guiding catheter, huh, because you have
right.
You have to be careful when you do that, okay? Not to damage the ostium of the stent.
It'll be interesting what this did to the osteal circ and how you're going to assess the osteal circ.
Yeah.
That's always the challenge.
So we'll do a control angio like that, okay?
Yes.
Okay, so the circ is clearly pinch.
Osteal LED is clearly underdone, mm-hmm. At least angiographically.
Yeah. Agreed.
Okay.
So
so what would the panel do at this point? Opinions?
I think we would depend on the iris to see how the minimal stent area of the RAD area.
Yeah.
If not that's happy, we can, you know, compromise using a 4-0 non-compressed. That's what your point.
Okay. Let's
but
do
probably
that.
It will not change too much because calcium nodules in the opposite. In the roof of the radios.
Well, I think it would be interesting. I'd like to do that. We've got some time. I'd like to IVUS, see the osteal LED, and then you'll see a 4-0 non-compliant short, and we'll see if it makes any difference.
Yeah.
Initially planned for FFR or the lab circumflex.
Yeah, so who, so let's get some opinions from the panel. Let's say that this is what the circ's going to look like at the, whatever we do with the LED. So who would, A, leave it alone, B, do an FFR, or C, treat it?
Leave it.
John?
I'd leave it.
John would leave it. Anybody else?
I think if you did an FFR, I think it's going to be positive, but...
So you think an FFR would be positive?
Yeah, I would look at it. I mean, you also look at it with IVUS.
All right, so who on the panel would just leave it if it looks like this?
Okay.
And who would do an FFR?
Let's do the IVUS.
Just treat it. Wow, exactly split.
I mean, you're going to get some information from the IVUS when it goes by as well. But as for the 4-0 with the ostium and the LED, I think you can blow it up there, but I think all that's going to happen is you're going to compress that ramus even more. I'm not sure it's going to... It may expand a little bit.
Yeah, the ramus is preserved. The ramus looks okay right now.
If you do anything
okay, so Gary, tell us what you're seeing.
Yeah.
Well, we've entered the stent. The distal edge was pristine in terms of size match. You know, now we're into some area of calcification, and you can see that the stent is a little bit irregular, but it's contoured toward by the calcium.
I think that was the original lesion there, I think.
Original lesion.
Did you make the
IVUS big? Lesion in the LED. What do you got big? It's full screen.
Well, it's not full screen.
No, it's not. It's
what we're seeing is the angiogram.
Well, great. Okay, so can they switch the IVUS to the full screen?
Yeah, do the opposite. The IVUS full screen.
It's the TV guys.
No.
Right. Do like this.
No, you're perfect. It's the
there
TV
you go.
Guys.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now you have it.
See, I made it big for you.
Very good.
You're great, Gary.
Okay.
You know, so an area of stent overlapping with the calcification.
Okay. It seems like this is pulling back at 0.25 mm/s. It seems slower than usual.
It's a long stent.
it's your jet lag, Greg.
I'm getting less patient as I age.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here's the circumflex coming in.
Yeah, so that's that spot. Yep.
Right. So we'll finish the pullback into left main.
Right.
And then I'll do a couple of quick measurements. So here's the left main stent. So this part looks fine.
Yeah, that looks fine.
And then we'll
okay.
take a quick look.
Yeah. All right, so let's make some measurements. And
so here is the left main, and here is the smallest part of the...
It's not terrible, but it's, you know...
It's not terrible, you know...
This may be where excellent is the enemy of good here.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Seven and a half, right?
Seven and a half. Seven. So it's not bad. What is it a little more distal?
Sorry?
Go a little bit more distal into the LAD.
Maybe we can prepare
how much does it open? Yeah, just somewhere there, like there. What's that, about 10?
While they are looking to that.
Nine.
So not terrible. And how about the distal left main? Very, very irregular looking. Really,
12.
Really elliptical. So, I don't think there's any definite right or wrong here. I mean, there is the consideration that if you do post-dilate it, you can further pinch the circum or the ramus. I still personally might put a 4-0 in that osteal LAD and then deal with the circ. I'm not too worried about that ramus. But let's get a sense from the panel. So how many people would do any more work on the LAD? Raise your hands. Just me. And how many people would leave the LAD alone? So most people are happy with the LAD. What do you think? Yeah. Except for me, Marie-Claude, I would do a 4-0 short balloon.
Okay.
This is going to be, the restenosis rate, this is the osteal LAD, and even though this is a DES, this is not a total trivial restenosis rate in this osteal LAD. And this kind of patient, you only want to be here one time.
What is the lumen, Greg, at the ostium of the LAD?
Seven and a half.
It's seven and a half. It's not bad. It's nine afterwards.
It's not bad.
I'm not being dogmatic. I don't feel super strongly.
Okay. Greg. So the next question to ask the audience or the panel. I think they put an FFR wire down the circumflex.
Yeah, that's what I would do for the circumflex personally.
But that's a zero it.
Okay. Yeah.
I'll bet it'll be fine.
During,
be interesting.
Yeah, I agree.
What I did during the discussion, it's put a wire in the pressure wire in the serve. So now we are equalizing. Can you show the?
And notice Marie-Claude had no trouble getting the jailed circ wire.
38. No. Eight.
No.
Okay.
Okay.
Did you equalize distal to the lesion or proximal to the lesion?
No. He pulled back and equalized.
Okay.
No, I pulled back. I pulled back to equalize. Okay. No. Okay. Equalize again.
Equalizing distal to the lesion was probably...
Yes.
It's a good thing that there is no need of doing anything.
Equalize distal the lesion during hyperemia. Okay.
Huh.
Okay.
Now we are equalized.
Are you going to give intravenous or intracoronary adenosine?
I don't know what the intravenous. So let's go.
Well, let's see what your resting gradient is.
How much?
There is no resting gradient.
Okay, so many people would say that's enough. You have zero resting gradient.
No.
Now, if you did an IFR, right, that, you know, you've got a PDPA of 0.98. Does anybody feel you need to give a medicine?
I would give it, but I would be flabbergasted if it's
I think the likelihood from the studies that we did, and we published this from the multicenter Resolve trial, and Gary knows this well, with a PDPA of 0.98 at rest, the likelihood of getting less than 0.8 is less than 5%. And while we say that, there you go.
Okay, but let's look and see where the distal wire is now.
Because right. Well, you have to pull back. There. If you believe it's 0.78,
yeah, there is a disease. Yes, I'm above the disease.
So pull back first, just to the distal cirque, and then proximal. You want to see that it's still
stop
one.
There for a second.
Still 7.
Wow.
0.74. Okay.
It's still significant.
Wow.
I will go more distally.
That's amazing.
That is very, very surprising. 0.6.
Yeah, you see, very distally, it's very 0.46.
Yeah, you put it just way up.
So pull back just past the osteocirc. Because this is a little problem because you're seeing diffuse disease in the circumflex.
Still.
Okay, so you see at really at the ostium there, you see 0.69.
So now pull back into the left main, and let's see if it goes to 1.0, and then we're convinced.
Yes.
Well, let's see. It's got to go to 1.0. It can't go to 0.83. Come to the osteo left main.
Okay.
If it doesn't go to 1.0, then it's adrift.
I am at the ostium.
Okay, so you've got drift. So you've got to re-equilibrate. You've got to re-equilibrate.
Okay, so
and then you've got to pass it again. So quickly equalize. Okay. That, you know, there's so much drift in these systems. You always have to do the pullback, and this is a great demonstration why. And the adenosine's still running, right?
Yeah, adenosine.
Okay, so as
soon
as it's...
You've got saline in the guide? Why is it on and off?
There's no wire introducer or anything, right? Tui Borst is closed.
No.
Yeah.
No, we know the game. Huh?
I know you do. It's just funny. I think we're all just very surprised.
Of course. I'm very interested too to redo it.
So why are we having trouble with the
They're re-zeroing it. They're just re-zeroing it. Okay.
Okay, so...
Just look at...
I don't know.
Equalize?
It's trying.
Oh, it is. It is now. Huh? It's okay. Huh? They are super equalized.
Okay, so now pass it past the osteal circ. Now you're 107.
Okay. I'm just past the...
Now you're 0.9. I got to tell you, this is what does drive me crazy about FFR sometimes.
Yeah.
I agree. Okay. I don't know what the other one was.
That makes more sense.
Yeah, it really does.
But
I think you were getting a lot of drift while you were running the other one for some reason. But so let's see what you are distal.
Now I'm distal, and
is the adenosine is still running?
90.
Adenosine is still running?
Adenosine is running, Okay.
So it's somewhere between 0.67 and 0.94.
Yeah, absolutely. You make...
This is, the companies have got to fix this drift issue.
That's going down again.
And you see, it's going down now. I don't understand why. I didn't move at all. And you see... I did not move at all,
People were saying the adenosine was off, and now it got restarted, but the lab was saying no.
No, you never stop the adenosine. Right.
Did you
oh, yes.
stop?
No, she did.
No. Continue.
Yeah, no, no, continue. Continue. You never stopped
it? She stopped it.
Yeah.
I think she stopped it.
She stopped it?
Maybe.
She stopped and restarted.
She restarted.
She restarted.
Yeah.
Ah.
Okay, so now it's restarted. So now you're going to have to repeat the whole thing again, because we don't even know if it's equilibrated again. So somebody, somebody tell her nicely not to stop the adenosine.
Well, you did confirm the fact that it, with the adenosine on, it was low.
Keep running.
I do the pullback now. So now
just wait there for a second.
Yeah. Yeah, so
you see that the ostium is not significant, 084, 085.
Right.
I am. You see where I am. I am just at the ostium.
Okay.
And if I continue to pull.
Let's see what it is. At the,
And now I'm
so here you're
so,
one. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
So, this
so it means that the distal lesion is significant, but not the ostium.
Okay.
But even now, you see the PDPA is not stable. Did she turn off the adenosine?
No.
Continue.
Ah, she needs to change the bottle because you will.
No adenosine.
This actually, this is a real world demonstration of the difficulties in doing an FFR procedure and interpreting it. I don't know the answer yet. I really don't.
You cannot do only single.
So actually, the question is,
okay. And we begin
what about the value of FFR if you have double or triple lesion? And how we really use the FFR if there are several lesions? What should be done first to see?
So you have to do a slow pullback, and then you're looking for a big step up, basically, across a focal lesion.
This is what we had.
So do you want to try one more time, or do you want to make a clinical decision?
There is a lot of P.
That's a other wire.
Yeah.
That might be the distal wire.
No, it's not. Did not move. Any of them moved. Okay, let's make a third and last.
Third and last
it's
try.
It's my last time. Huh? Okay, so let's equalize again, please.
Yeah.
And you put
We're gonna have to leave you in 2 minutes. Maybe we can just see the very quickly.
Okay. So let's. Okay. So it's equalized.
Not yet.
Not quite yet.
Okay. Can you equalize, please?
Okay.
Equalize after the lesion.
Okay, it's done.
All right.
So now.
So just go just past the lesion. Okay, fine.
So this is the proximal.
Yeah. And you might try to disengage the guide a little bit. You know, sometimes the guide can impede smooth adenosine flow.
Okay.
That's good.
Okay. And you see, proximal, the ostial circle doesn't need anything.
So the adenosine is running? Did she started the adenosine?
I think she's still working
on it. Yeah. Adenosine is running.
She's still working on it.
She's still working on it.
Ah.
Okay, well, it has stayed equalized.
It's on? Okay, now we are on.
Okay.
And I am distal to the second lesion,
Let's wait till we see hyperemia.
Is this going in a peripheral vein?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. And we're at 140 mics per kilo. Is that the dose?
All right.
Yeah.
So here we're getting hyperemia.
It's going down.
So it's getting there.
Yeah.
All
Okay.
All right, so it looks like about 0.82, 0.83. So you might want to pull back.
Yeah, it's stable.
Okay, so you want to pull back a little bit. And let's see. Let's see if it stayed at 1.0.
Okay, now I am proximal.
So here around point...
Seven, so it's ostium of the...
So 0.86, 0.87.
Sir, yeah, which is okay.
And then let's see at the ostial left main, does it go to one? Pretty close.
Yes,
so pretty
it goes
good.
To
okay,
one.
So
yeah.
right around 0.86, yeah.
so
0.87.
You're convinced?
I think that's believable. So would everybody leave it at this point?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we're all comfortable leaving it. Good persistence.
Yeah.
So now you can tell her to turn off the adenosine so it doesn't run for the rest of the case.
Okay, you can Marie stop Claude, the adenosine.
So just tell us, Marie-Claude, what you're going to do. Are you done or are you going to do anything else for the LAD?
No, for me, I'm done. I will
Excellent.
Detail the wires to
Great.
Show you that
Notice the Ramus wire
disappear.
Comes out easily. Fantastic.
And,
Thank you so much. Great case. I want to thank all the panelists. This was very, very interesting. Two beautiful cases by the masters. Thank you, everybody.